تبسم تبسم وخل الهموم وخل الغموم وخل الضجر.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين وعلى آله وأصحابه الطاهرين ما دام ما في السماوات والأرضين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما. يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى في محكم تنزيله: إن عدة الشهور عند الله 12 إلى آخر الآية. صدق الله العظيم، ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين والشاكرين، والحمد لله رب العالمين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. Respected brothers and sisters in Islam, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through whose infinite grace and mercy we are once again gathered in this noble place, the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, on this most noble day, the day of Jumu'ah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in His infinite wisdom, has chosen to give certain things preference over other things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen to give certain days preference over other days, certain months preference over other months, certain individuals preference over other individuals, certain places preference over other places. And this particular concept of giving some things preference over others is best encapsulated and best captured by the words of Qatada ibn Da'ama rahimahullah, who was a student of Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu ta'ala an, who was in turn one of the glorious companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and more well known as Khadim Rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as the personal aid to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, إن الله اصطفى صفايا من خلقه. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen certain individuals from amongst His creation. اصطفى من الملائكة رسلا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen and given preference to certain of the angels above others. We don't know the amount of angels that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created. لا يعلم جنود ربك إلا هو. That we do not know the size of the army of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No one knows except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But of all these angels, we know the greatest angel, the archangel, is none other than Jibreel alayhi salam. So from all the angels, Jibreel alayhi salam is the greatest angel. واصطفى من الكلام ذكرى. And from speech, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given certain speech preference over other speech. Certain speech is much better than other speech. And from all of speech, the greatest of speech is the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. واصطفى من الأرض المساجد. And from all the places on the earth, on the surface of the earth, the place most beloved to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are those places in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is worshipped. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has it in a narration that the most beloved place to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are the masajid, and the most hated and the most disliked place in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are the marketplaces, for obvious reasons. وَاصْطَفَى مِنَ الشُّهُورِ رَمَضَانِ. And from amongst all the months, the 12 months that we have in the year, in the Islamic lunar calendar, of these 12 months, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given certain of these months preference over other months. This is once again at the beginning of our Islamic New Year. For us to once again look, we're quite familiar with the solar calendar and the solar months, but we might not be as familiar with the lunar calendar and the lunar months. And why this is very important is because all the rulings, the rules and the regulations, the injunctions of our Sharia contained in the Quran and the way of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when it is related to time, it is not related to the solar calendar, but rather it is related to the lunar calendar. So we might have memorized the solar months, but what about the Islamic months? Muharram, Safar, Rabiul Awwal, Rabiul Thani, Jamadil Ula, Jamadil Ukhra, Rajab, Sha'ban, Ramadan, Shawwal, Dhul Qa'dah, and Dhul Hijjah. Like we are familiar with the other months, the lunar months, the solar months, we must familiarize ourselves with the lunar calendar as well. Look, the solar calendar does have a number of benefits in a sense that the solar calendar is fixed. Every year is exactly the same. January, February, March, it doesn't rotate. So that benefits us in a sense that we can do our year planners. We can plan our terms, the first term, the second term, third term, and the fourth terms. So in terms of business management, in terms of our academic year, in terms of our financial year, we can plan well ahead of time. So that is on its place, and that is the manner that we benefit from the solar calendar. But the lunar calendar is of equal or even greater importance. Why? Simply because all our ritual acts of worship is not tied into the lunar, the solar calendar, but rather it is tied into the lunar calendar. The days of Hajj are heralded by what? It's heralded by the month of Dhul Hijjah, and that is based according to the lunar calendar. So we should take this time to, inshallah, familiarize ourselves with the Islamic months. What Islamic date is it? What Islamic month is it? What Islamic year is it? And not only ourselves, but rather we should impart this to our children as well. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like He has given preference to certain things over and above other things, in the same way the months of the year, He has chosen to give certain months preference over other months. And when we talk about the months of the year, obviously the greatest month in our calendar is the month of Ramadan, the month in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed the Holy Quran. But besides the month of Ramadan, right, Qatada informs us, and this is obviously based on the Quran and based on the traditions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which we will discuss in a short bit. He says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from amongst all the months, He has chosen Ramadan wal ashhurul hurum, and He has chosen the sacred months. Which are those sacred months? In a short bit, inshallah, we will discuss that. وَاصْطَفَى مِنَ الْأَيَّامِ يَوْمَ الْجُمُعَةِ. And from amongst all the days, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen the day of Jumu'ah. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, خَيْرُ يَوْمٍ طَلَعَتْ عَلَيْهِ الشَّمْسُ يَوْمُ الْجُمُعَةِ. That the best day upon which the sun rises is none other than this day of Jumu'ah. وَاصْطَفَى مِنَ الْلَيَالِ لَيْلَةَ الْقَدْرِ. And from all the nights, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen the night of power, worship in which is better than worshipping for 1,000 months. فَعَظِّمُوا مَا عَظَّمَ اللَّهِ. And after informing us of the months that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given preference to, the days which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given preference to, the individual which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given preference to, He ends off by telling us, فَعَظِّمُوا مَا عَظَّمَ اللَّهِ. Then glorify that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made great. Regard as big that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made big. We know that we have formally entered into what we colloquially refer to as the silly season. The silly season, Jamaatul Muslimin, has officially started. The silly season is marked by what we refer to as big days. The biggest day being New Year's Day, Boxing Day, Day, etc., etc. Now, these big days, who has made these days big? Has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made these days big? In our listing, what we have rendered from Qatada, He has spoken about individuals, He has spoken about months, He has spoken about days. Anywhere in this catalogue of big days, has He ever referred to New Year's Day, the solar New Year's Day? Has He ever referred to Christmas Day? Has He ever referred to Boxing Day? And He tells us specifically, only regard those days as big which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has deemed as big. We are in our big days. This is our big day. Our big day has already started 3 days ago, when the month of Muharram, when we cited the lunar calendar for the month of Muharram. So we shouldn't be celebrating days which the West are celebrating, but rather we as Muslims have our own big days, and we should celebrate these days in the true spirit of Islam. فَإِنَّمَا تَعْظِيمُ الْأُمُورِ بِمَا عَظَّمَهَا اللَّهِ. When we glorify something, we only glorify it because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has attached a certain importance to those particular days. Khair. Let's look at the Holy Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala once again talks about the months of the year. And He says to us, إِنَّ عِدَّةَ شُهُورِ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ 12 شَهْرًا. That the amount of months in the year by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has set out the time, it is 12 months. And of those 12 months, there are what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to in the Holy Quran as Ashhurul Hurum. These are basically, besides the month of Ramadan, these are basically 4 months. And of those 4 months, we find that 3 of those months run consecutively. And the 1 month is later on in the year. These 3 months that run consecutively is none other than Dhul Qa'dah, Dhul Hijjah, and the month that we find ourselves in now, which is none other than Muharram. The reason why it is referred to as Muharram is, and in some narrations we find that this month of Muharram is referred to as Shahrullah al-Muharram, the month of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Attributing this month to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, further establishing the sanctity and the auspiciousness of this particular month. So you have Dhul Qa'dah, Dhul Hijjah, and the month of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which we refer to as Muharram. And then later on in the year, we have what we refer to as Rajab. In a short while, inshallah, I'll mention the rendition of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he talks about this month. Now, these months were set up when? يَوْمَ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. On the day when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the heavens and the earth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala already set out the months. Now, why is this very significant for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to mention this? That there are 12 months in the year, and those months have been set out by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the day He created the heavens and the earth. It is simply because the non-believers of Makkah, the pagan Arabs, they were guilty of switching the months around. Even amongst the pagan Arabs, they would regard these months as sanctimonious, as great. So much so that we know from the pagan Arabs, they were almost perennially at war, always fighting with one another. For the smallest dispute, it would lead on to a war that would last a lifetime and even would spill over to the next lifetime. So trivial were they. But despite this tendency that they used to have for warfare, in these months, in these 4 months, the sacred months, they would desist from fighting. They wouldn't fight in these months. And if you look at it, the pagan Arabs, they would also perform the pilgrimage, the Hajj. So if we look at these 4 months, let's look at the first three, Dhul Qa'dah, Dhul Hijjah, and Muharram. Now Dhul Qa'dah and Dhul Hijjah, those are the months of Hajj. So they would take a break from fighting and allow everybody to go perform the Hajj. And obviously from after Hajj, you need time to get from the holy lands back to your place. So they would regard Muharram as sanctimonious as well. So no fighting in Dhul Qa'dah, no fighting in Dhul Hijjah, and no fighting in Muharram. Then later on in the year, in order to allow everybody to peacefully once again come to the Baytullah, come to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to perform the Umrah, they would say, in Rajab there's no fighting. So good and well, this is what they did. But because of the tendency to want to fight, if they had reason to fight, for example, in the month of Muharram, they would say, you know what we do this year? This year we're going to change Muharram out for Safar. So what happens is, we will fight in Muharram, and then we'll regard Safar as sanctimonious, and we won't fight in Safar. And in doing this, in playing around with the months, the whole setup and the whole order of all these months were jumbled up. But on the day that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam performed the Hajjatul Wada', he said to those companions, amongst a number of things which he said to the companions who were surrounding him, he said to them that ala inna zaman qad istadara li hay'atihi yawma khalaqa Allahu samawati wal ard, that the times have changed and the months have moved, but the months have moved in such a manner that it had actually corrected itself. And as of this year, Hajjatul Wada, on the Fiwal Hajj, the order of the months, that as it stands now, this is the correct order by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which He had set into place the day that He had created the heavens and the earth. There's a long tradition which talks about some very pertinent advices to us revolving around Muharram, and then also about certain other issues which I will very briefly mention to you inshallah, and then we'll progress to the next point. At this occasion of Hajj, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked his companions a number of what we refer to as rhetorical question. A rhetorical question is when you ask a question and you don't really want an answer, but you're simply asking the question for another reason. But look at the etiquette, the adab of the companions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He asks them, what day is this? So everybody obviously knows that this day is the day of Yawmun Nahr, is the day of Eid. But none of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam reply, and they simply say, Allahu wa Rasulu a'lam. That's one of the first lessons we can learn from this rather long narration. The humility, the humbleness that the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had in front of him. They wouldn't answer immediately, even though they very well knew the answer of what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asking about. So he asked, which day is this? Which month is this? Which city is this? And then he replies and he gives them the answer to all of these questions. This is the day of Nahr. Which month are we? We are in the holy month of Dhul Hijjah, Ashhurul Hurum. And then which city are we in? We are in the holy city of Mecca. And the Prophet ﷺ tells him, just as sanctimonious as this day is, as this month is, as the city is, in the same way that إِنَّ دِمَاءَكُمْ وَأَمْوَالَكُمْ, that your blood, your life in relation to one another, وَأَمْوَالَكُمْ, and your wealth in relation to one another, وَأَعْرَاضَكُمْ, and your honor in relation to one another, as sanctimonious as this time is, as this place is, as this month is, as sanctimonious all of this is, in the same way your wealth, your life and your honor is sanctimonious towards you. Okay. The next issue I want to focus on is the month of Muharram itself. And we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for having afforded us this opportunity to witness another Muharram, another new year, another new beginning. And we take this opportunity to wish each and every person a Muharram Mubarak. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make this year better than next year. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make this year a year of barakah, blessing, a year of prosperity, a year of khair, and whatever good there is, inshallah. Initially, we know it is sunnah to fast on the 10th of Muharram. Before, it was compulsory to fast on the 10th of Muharram. Before the fasting of the month of Ramadan was institutionalized, became compulsory, before it was enacted, it was compulsory to fast 3 days a month, and annually you must fast the day of Ashura, on the 10th of Muharram. Afterwards, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enacted the fasting of the month of Ramadan, but initially it was not compulsory. If you had the ability to fast, you didn't necessarily have to fast. If you didn't fast, you simply had to pay a fidya, a sort of penalty. But then afterwards, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made even the fasting of the month of Ramadan compulsory. فَمَنْ شَهِدَ مِنْكُمُ الشَّهْرَ فَلْيَصُمْهُ. If you witness the month of Ramadan, it is compulsory to fast on the month of Ramadan. So initially, to fast on the 10th of Muharram was compulsory. As for now, it is only sunnah for us to fast on the, not only sunnah, it is a sunnah for us to fast on the 10th of Muharram. And this is further borne out from this following narration, where it is said, كَانَ يَوْمُ عَاشُورَ تَصُومُ قُرَيْشِ فِي الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ, that the 10th of Muharram was a day in which the pagan Arabs used to fast. وَكَانَ رَسُولُ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلِّمْ يَصُومُ فِي الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم also used to uphold this fast. فَلَمَّا قَدِمَ الْمَدِينَ صَامَهُ وَأَمَرَ بِصِيَامِهِ. When the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم came to Medina, he continued fasting the 10th of Muharram, and he ordered the companions to fast as well. فَلَمَّا فُرِضَ رَمَضَانَ. When Ramadan was made compulsory, تَرَكَ يَوْمَ عَشُورَ, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left off the fasting of the day of Ashura. Not left it off entirely, but left it off in a sense that is no longer compulsory. فَمَنْ شَاءَ صَامَهُ وَمَنْ شَاءَ تَرَكَهُ. Therefore, a person now had a discretion. If he wanted to fast on the 10th of Muharram, good and well. If for whatever reason he didn't want to fast on that day, then also good and well. So that is the first point which I wanted to mention. The fasting on the 10th of Muharram, it is a sunnah. And we should try to uphold this fast bi-idhnillahi subhanahu wa ta'ala. And for another reason as well, because when we fast on the 10th of Muharram, it's not simply a fast, but we are fasting a day which is from amongst the days of the Ashhurul Hurum, in such a season where the rewards are multiplied. The rewards for a good deed is multiplied. Look, when you visit the holy lands and you go to Mecca and you go to Medina, the very same salah that you would perform here, if you perform that salah either in the Masjid of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam or in the Baytullah, you know, in the holy mosque in Mecca, then you will get an increased reward. So like when you make a salah in a different place, you get more reward. In the same way, when you do a ritual act of worship in a certain time, you will get much more reward. So likewise, if you do any good acts of worship in this particular time, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is prepared to reward you double, triple-fold. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is prepared to increase the reward for you. And at the same time, we need to mention as well, that like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is prepared to give you a greater reward for good deeds which you do, in the same way, if you disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you go against the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the sacred time, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will punish you even greater. So we need to keep this in mind. Therefore Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Holy Quran, فَلَا تَظْلِمُوا فِيهِنَّ أَنفُسَكُمْ. Do not transgress yourselves فِيهِنَّ in these months. So we can look at this verse in one of two ways. It can either refer to all times, but in terms of the context of this particular verse, it refers to al-ashhurul hurum, to these sacred months. Don't wrong yourselves by transgressing the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in these particular sacred months. Therefore we find, very interestingly, another substantiation that clearly tells us that when you do something wrong in these months, it is a greater atrocity. Imam Shafi rahmatullah alayhi said, normally, if you are familiar with the penal law in Islam, Islam has a penal law that when you commit a certain transgression, you are punished in a certain way. Like for example, if you are driving, we're all a bit hyped up about the amendments that they've made to the traffic law. And the amendments, you might lose your license, you might be blacklisted, etc., etc. So when you are guilty of a certain transgression, there's a certain punishment. In the same way in Islam, we have a certain penal code, a corporal punishment, a system. If you steal, your hands are chopped off. If you commit fornication, you are lashed. If you commit adultery, you are stoned to death. In the same way, when you take the life of somebody, there's a certain punishment. Now, according to Imam Shafi rahmatullah alayhi, usually the punishment is that you have to pay a diya. From amongst other things, you have to pay a diya. Now, a diya simply translates as a fine. But when you kill somebody in these sacred months, then you have that fine, instead of being 100 specific camels, it becomes 100 more costly camels. So at the end of the day, it will cost you more than if you kill somebody within these months. Which clearly proves to us, once again, that the ulama of the sharia, when they look at these months and they look at transgressions in this month, it is really a big concept. The next issue which I'd like to discuss, and this is a very important issue, and it is a very interesting development in relation to the day of Ashura. It talks about the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he comes to Medina. When he comes to Medina, now the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is invited from Mecca to Medina. He immigrates from Mecca and he comes to Medina. Medina, to a certain degree, is a cosmopolitan society, right? You have the, which we would later refer to as the Ansar. But the Ansar were initially broken up into two tribes. They were the Aus and the Khazraj. They would later come together and be known as the Ansar, the helpers of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And together with them, you had certain Jewish tribes within Medina, right? And they were Banu Qaynuqa, Banu Nadir, and Banu Qurayza. So when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to Medina, he came to this cosmopolitan community. And he noticed that the Jews, they were fasting on this particular day, on this day of Ashura. And he inquired, how is it that the Jews are also fasting on this day? And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is informed that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved Musa alayhi salam from the treachery and the clutches of Fir'aun on this particular day. So in celebration of that, we are fasting on this particular day. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam responds to them in a very unique way. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells him that ana ahaqqu bi Musa minkum. Ana ahaqqu bi Musa minkum. If you are fasting in celebration of this particular day, then I am more rightful to observe this fast than what you are. Because my allegiance to the religion of Musa alayhi salam is a much stronger and much true allegiance than what your claimed allegiance to Musa alayhi salam is. Now, when we look at this, how do we translate this incident to make it very relative to us? If we look at us, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam coming from Mecca to Medina to find this cosmopolitan society in Medina, And then he witnesses the Jews doing something good. And he says that if you are doing that good, then I am more rightful to do this good. What happens is that society, that cosmopolitan society, is very much similar to our current situation, where we are a Muslim minority in Cape Town. We are basically surrounded not only by Jews, we are surrounded by Christians, and basically every ideology that you could possibly think of, we interact with him. So what happens is, as a Muslim society, we see that there are possibly non-Muslim organizations that are doing good work, that are doing sterling community work, NGOs, etc., etc. What should our attitude towards them be? What should our approach be towards them? It should be the telltale, the very same approach that the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ had when he came to Medina. He saw the Jews doing something good and he said, "Ana ahaqqu bi Musa minkum." I am more rightful to do that good act. If we are seeing people having a soup kitchen, what should we tell them? No, we should say that, you know, as a Muslim, it is more my duty to do what you are doing and put our shoulder to the wheel. If we find somebody has a, whatever it may be, a drug rehabilitation center, anybody doing any form of work. Now, recently we had the launch of a drive, which is called the Lead SA Drive, for the civil society of South Africa to take the initiative and put steps into place whereby they can better the conditions of South Africans as a whole. What should our attitude as Muslims be towards this? نَحْنُ أَحَقُّ مِنْكُمْ بِذَاكُ. That as Muslims, we are more rightful and it is more our duty to do whatever good work that you are currently doing. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq, inshallah, to adapt this type of attitude. And like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had in regard to this particular issue. Last but not least, two more points inshallah before we end off. In yet another narration, Ibn Abbas tells us that on the 10th of Muharram, when you fast on the 10th of Muharram, we know the Jews used to fast on the 10th of Muharram. Now the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted to distinguish himself as well as the Muslims from the Jews, simply because we have a distinct identity, not because we have any prejudice towards the Jews or the Christians, but simply because a Muslim has his own distinct identity. And therefore, in this regard, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is reported to have said, "This year I fasted the 10th of Muharram. Come next year, what I'll do is, just in order to differentiate and to distinguish myself from the Jews, I will fast either on the 9th and the 10th or on the 10th and the 11th." So look, in this particular aspect, in acts of worship, if the Prophet ﷺ wants to distinguish himself from the Jews and the Christians and everybody else, what about the other aspects of our life? So we can do one of three things. We can either fast the 10th of Muharram, which is good and well, or we can fast the 9th, 10th, and 11th, which is the best, or we can simply fast the 10th and the 11th, whichever one is easy for us. But the important point to keep in mind, why do we fast the 9th and the 10th? Why do we fast the 10th and the 11th? Is to differentiate ourselves and distinguish ourselves from the next person, run-of-the-mill person, the next Jewish person, the next Christian person, etc., etc., because we need to establish our own identity. And that's very important for us to realize, especially as a Muslim minority living in what we can refer to as a diaspora. We are about plus minus in the Western Cape, 500,000, 750,000, a million Muslims at the most. And how many million people aren't there in the Western Cape? We are a minority. And what we have to do is we necessarily have to protect our identity. Look, if you're going to assimilate, if you're going to adapt the norms and the cultures of other people, if it doesn't go against the grain of the Quran and the way of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but that's fine. But when you start assimilating, when you start adapting certain values, certain ways, which goes against the Holy Quran and which goes against the way of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then we'll definitely be sitting with a problem. So this is one of the lessons which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is teaching us in this particular regard. And then lastly, inshallah, we have seen now from the Quran, we have seen from the traditions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we have seen from the statement of Qatada ibn Da'amah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his messenger and the ulama, they have afforded a certain sacredness to these months and these days. And specifically now we talk about Muharram. And in the month of Muharram, specifically the 10th of Muharram, The sanctimoniousness and the sacredness and the greatness of this particular day is something which is almost eternal, something which is almost ancient. Right? يَوْمَ خَلَقَ اللَّهُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. From the day that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has afforded this month its sanctity. Right? And it's very important to mention this, because you'll find from many quarters it is propagated that the 10th of Muharram draws its significance from the martyrdom of Hussein radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa arda. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with him. The sacredness and auspiciousness of this particular day and of this particular month and of these months is not drawn from the martyrdom of Hussein radiallahu ta'ala anhu, but rather it is something which is established in the Quran, in the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, well before that, which doesn't say that we don't feel empathy and we don't recognize the martyrdom of Hussein radiallahu ta'ala anhu, ma'adha lillah. We do recognize the grandson of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we do express our empathy and our sadness that it is on this day that the grandchild of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that very person who used to play on the back of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that very person who would share in the food of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that as a result of the treachery of the people of Iraq, as a result of the treachery he was martyred, you know, and also Yazid and his army was also implicit in the killing of Hussein radiallahu ta'anhu. We acknowledge that and we bemoan that. But at the end of the day, that this particular day, that the Yawm of Ashura, the significance of it does not come from the martyrdom of Hussein radiallahu ta'anhu, but rather it comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So fasting of the day of Ashura, it's a ritual act of worship whereby we celebrate when Musa alayhi salam was saved from the clutches of Fir'aun, where we celebrate the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in that he fasted on this particular day and we will fast in a similar day. It is not a commemoration of the martyrdom of Hussein radiallahu anhu that occurred at Karbala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the true understanding, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us in the right direction. When I was preparing today's talk, it is a very sensitive talk in a certain way. And I've tried not to make it a narrative, but I've rather tried to put these into point form. And primarily, our responsibility as the fraternity of ulama, as the fraternity of scholarship, over and above standing and leading the Jummah Salah, over and above sermonizing, over and above taking out the janazah, over and above giving the new baby a name, the most important duty and the responsibility to which the ulama would be held responsible by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of Qiyamah is the issue of irshad, providing that necessary guidance. Alhamdulillah, we are fortunate enough, we are very fortunate that when we come to this particular masjid, amongst many other masajid in Cape Town, what we are getting from the front is that very same hidayah, that very same irshad, that very same guidance which the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has come with, and we are proud to be conduits of that particular irshad. So when we come to the masjid and when we listen to our ulama, it is not simply just listening, but rather it is irshad, it is guidance, it is direction which we are ultimately taking from our ulama. So I hope inshallah that today's talk inshallah will be a sense of irshad, a sense of guidance, a sense of pointing out the right way in what do we do in this particular month, what do we uphold in this month, what do we not uphold in this month, and so forth. Wa akhiru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alamin.
تبسم تبسم وخل الهموم وخل الغموم وخل الضجر.